Hello, and thank you for joining today's webinar at the New York Botanical Garden. I am Benjamin Torkey, Associate Curator in the Institute of Systematic Botany at the Garden. It's my pleasure to welcome you for today's presentation, Systematics of Stylosanthes, Focusing on the Brazilian Species by Danilo Gissi. At any time during today's event, you are welcome to submit questions by clicking on the Q&A button at the bottom of your window, and we will gather these for our speaker to answer at the end of the presentation. Live captions can be enabled by clicking the CC button, then Show Subtitles or View Full Transcript. Today's presentation is being recorded and will be available in the NYBG Lecture Library. Danilo S. Gissi is a PhD candidate in the Department of Biostatistics, Plant Biology, Parasitology, and Zoology at the Institute of Biosciences at São Paulo State University in Brazil. He's an expert on the systematics of the legume genus Stylosanthes in particular. He has a bachelor's degree in biology from the Luiz de Queiroz College of Agriculture at the University of São Paulo, and also a master's degree from the Institute of Biosciences, also at the University of São Paulo. His broad interests focus on the taxonomy, phylogeny, and anatomy of flowering plants, especially members of the legume family Fabaceae or Leguminosae. But he has also done some work with ferns and lycophytes. Danilo has been awarded a fellowship from the Coordination for the Improvement of Higher Education Personnel, also known as CAPES, which is part of the Ministry of Education in Brazil, and which fosters the mobility of Brazilian PhD students abroad. He's using this funding to develop part of his doctoral research here in the herbarium of the New York Botanical Garden. Danilo actually arrived at NYBG with me hosting him at the beginning of 2020, but then had to return to Brazil, obviously, only a few months due to the pandemic-related closure of the garden. He was finally able to return to NYBG in November of 2021 and will continue his studies here through April of this year. So it's really a pleasure to have Danilo with us. And with that, I would ask that you please join me in welcoming today's speaker, Danilo Gissi. Danilo, I'll turn it over to you.
Hey, thank you very much, Ben. Now I'm going to share my presentation. Okay, I hope everybody's seeing them. So before I start the subject, I'm going to talk a little bit my background. I was raised in the countryside in a small town in São Paulo. And there I got an intimate contact with nature, plants, and animals. So I decided I want to be a biologist. Then I entered university in 2009 with only 16 years. And in the first year, I already started engaging in botany. I made my first field trip in 2010. And already I graduated in 2013. And I still continue to study botany, to do my master's, and after I decided to make a doctorate. And it was possible to me to make my first international travel in 2020. When I was awarded the CAP Sprint Scholarship, I decided to come here to the New York Botanical Garden because it has a long history in legume research, especially starting with Rupert Barnaby. He also collected plenty of material from Brazil and is deposited here. Then Professor Ben Torque succeeded him and continued to study legumes also from Brazil. And now I have this opportunity to study all this material. My presentation will be divided in two sections. The first section, I will give a little background of the legumes, where the genus Stylosanthes is located. And after, I'll go into deep into my PhD thesis. So the Leguminosae is the bean family. It's the one of the largest family of flowering plants in the world. It has around 70 genera and 20,000 species. In Brazil, it is the largest family of flowering plants. It has 253 genera and 3,025 species. They're very easy to be recognized. These plants have compound and alternate leaves, mainly with stipules. The flowers has 5 sepals and 5 petals. They always have a superior ovary with only 1 carpel. And the fruits are generally legumes. Well, since it's a huge family, we might expect there are exceptions from this archetype. Talking about importance economically, is the second most important just behind grasses. They're a great food source. They also are called pulses. So in the family where are the beans, the soybeans, lentils, peas, and many other grains. Also, they are a great source of wood. Many trees are used for this timber, like rosewood, Brazil wood, garapeira, kumaru, and black locust. I give this example of the native plant garden that here in the New York Botanical Garden. It's all made from black locust tree. They're also a great source of dyes. The most famous of it is the Brazil wood or pau Brasil. They were so important during the 16th century that even the country was named after this tree. And just an interesting fact, the ink made from pau Brasil was found in Van Gogh paintings also. They generally have very beautiful flowers, and many of the species are used for ornamentation and urban forestry. And they also, many species are used for feeding livestock. Many genera are used for it, but the most important genera of legume fodder is Stylosanthes. And one of the reasons of the great success of the leguminosae is because they have nitrogen-fixing bacteria in their roots. This bacteria absorbs the photosynthetic products of the plants and give back nitrogen compounds to the plants. Well, those who are taxonomists might have already heard about the classification of the legumes. They were previously classified into 3 subfamilies, Caesopinioideae, Mimosoideae, and Papilionoideae. However, since the first studies of phylogeny, it's been known that Caesopinioideae do not form a monophyletic group, so it's required a further classification. After years of discussion, they finally arrived in the consensus of dividing the family into 6 subfamilies. There are Cercidioideae, Dialioideae, Duperquercioideae, Detarioideae, Papilionoideae, and Caesopinioideae remained with some members, but now is including the Mimosoid clade. Sorry. No. So the Stylosanthes belongs to the Papilionoid subfamily. It has 500 genera and around 14,000 species. They are recognized by its Papilionoideus corolla. That's a corolla who has an outer and petal called banner, 2 lateral petals called wings, and 2 fused petals called keel. And the subfamily is relatively divided into 28 tribes. So the tribe in which Stylosanthes is inserted is the tribe Dalbergieae. The Dalbergieae are recognized by its ischneumonoid nodules at the roots. It's a monophyletic tribe and is divided with three major clades. The first is the Desmia clade, the second is the Dalbergia clade, and the Pterocarpus clade, which belongs to Stylosanthes. Well, the Pterocarpus clade is very diverse with some interesting members. For example, we have a platymecium that has opposite leaves, which is very rare feature in legumes. The Arachis hypogea is the peanut, and these fruits are maturing underground. So if you want to eat peanuts from a peanut plant, you need to dig out the plant. For example, central lobium tomentoso is very common in the Atlantic forest. It has this huge samaroid fruits. And even Inocarpus is a genus very weird. And if you give it a first look, you won't notice it's a legume, but it belongs to the Pterocarpus clades as well. Now I'm gonna talk more specifically about Stylosanthes. Its geographic distribution is mainly Pan-American. They're occurring in open habitats. The Brazil is the country with the most number of species, especially in the Cerrado, followed by Mexico and West Indies. Some species occur in North America, and just five species are found in Africa. If you see Stylosanthes in Asia and Australia, they are probably introduced. And one of the reasons I started to study Stylosanthes is because it's agronomic relevance. Stylosanthes is used to farm pastures for feeding cattle, especially because they are very resistant to drought and low fertility soils. And also they have high protein content. But one of the problems with Stylosanthes is that they are very susceptible to anthracnose, that's the fungus that attacks the plants. But some cultivars are being developed to be more resistant to anthracnose. The most famous is Stylosanthes Campo Grande, was developed by Embrapa. It constitutes of Stylosanthes captata and Stylosanthes macrocephala. And recently, it was released the new cultivar called Stylosanthes bella, that's made from Stylosanthes guineensis. They're also very weedy species. They can infest lawns and pastures. So if you live in tropical areas or even in warmer regions here in the United States, you can find them in your backyard, in gardens. So to recognize Stylosanthes, they are subshrubs with trifoliate leaves. They have stipules that are united and embrace the stem. The inflorescences are spikes, and the flowers are generally yellow or whitish. The fruits are very distinct. They are lomentaceous. They can have just only one or two fertile articles. And they also have a structure on the top called rostrum. The rostrum is the remnant style and the shape, the length. And the indumentum of the rostrum is very useful for the distinguished species. Actually, some people send me a picture of the flower of Stylosanthes and says, how could you identify for me? And I always said, I need the fruit to see to have a more efficient identification. So Vogel in 1838 divided the genus into two sections, especially based on the bracteoles. So the first section is Stylosanthes section, Stylosanthes, to comprise species only one inner bracteole and no rudimentary axis, and the section Stylosanthes from two inner bracteoles and one rudimentary axis. The rudimentary axis is that a structure pointed with the arrow, and we believe that must be an aborted flower. If you see in the image at the right, you can even see the calyx of an aborted flower present. So field works with phylogeny have been done. The genus is monophyletic, but the sections were not. If you see in the clade in the left, you can notice that the species in red are from the section Stylosanthes, and the species were not marked are the section Stylosanthes, so they mix together. So this classification is not consistent. But in another phylogeny made from made by Souza Costa, an interesting fact is that the species from the Guianensis complex, there's a species complex, they are merged together and they form one clade. This is a very interesting group, and I'm very focusing on it, because for different taxonomic treatments, it has different concepts. Sometimes they are all treated only one species with several varieties. Sometimes different species, and others like this latest project by Vani, he considered only one species and just two varieties. So now I'm gonna start to emphasize my thesis. I'm sorry. So to realize it, I made some field expeditions. I collect material and fix it in formaldehyde. I also gather samples from various specimens that were hydrated. I made transverse sections using hand razor blades and also performed some chemical tests on fresh material. I analyzed all this in stereo microscope and in scanning electron microscopy. Also, I've studied several herbarium material, especially from herbarium from Brazil, but also here from the New York Botanical Garden. And thankfully, there are many photographs of specimens available online. So during the pandemic, I used a lot of it. So I could analyze specimens from herbarium all over the world. And we got now a published article called Leaf and Stem Anatomy of the Stylosanthes Guianensis Complex and its systematic significance. It was published in Flora Journal this year. So when I start to analyze the anatomy of the stem, we notice that there are some long secondary appendages in the epidermis, and they're usually referred as hairs, bristles, or even trichomes in the literature. So we decide to study the development of these structures. And we notice that start to develop at the protodermis of the leaf, and then cells from the ground meristems start to form a bulge in the base of the structure. So it begins to form a secretory base of these long appendages. Since it has protodermal and ground meristem origin, we need to call them emergences and not trichomes, because trichomes have only protodermal origin. So we performed stochemistry tests to see what these secretory appendages, secretory emergences produce. So we've seen that it produces lipids and polysaccharides. Also, Generally, they form droplets in the tip of the emergences, and we decide to stain them. When stained with retinal red and PAS, they react positively for polysaccharides. When we stain with Sudan, we detect lipids. And when we stain with native reagents, we detect terpenes. So they all react positively for them. And we just think about a little bit of the function of the secretory emergencies. Probably they are related with reduced water loss and all act as a light reflector, lowering the temperature of the leaves. And also because they have terpenes, they can act as defense from herbivores. Actually, a very interesting article has shown that larvae of the cattle tick as trapped and poisoned by the viscous fluid produced by these secretory emergencies. And if you see other Dalbergieae, we've seen that Solar Rader, in his extensive work with anatomy of underworms, had detected multicellular shaggy hairs in several Dalbergieae specimens. So perhaps these emergencies are more widespread in the Dalbergieae group, but of course it needs further studies. When we start to see the leaf anatomy, we notice that there are idioblasts inside the mesophyll. So we have mucilage idioblasts at the abaxial sides, and phenolic idioblasts at the abaxial side. Actually, these phenolic idioblasts also form a network in the abaxial side of the leaf. Another interesting feature is the size of the fiber caps that are adjacent to the phloem. So, analyzing all these features, we could just separate some taxa regarding the morphological findings. So we noticed that the emergence and trichome distribution is very useful to distinguish some taxa within the Stylosanthes guineensis complex. For example, Stylosanthes guineensis varietica nascens, that's this species, it doesn't have the secretory emergences that is found in the guineensis variety guineensis. And also the position of the non-glandular trichomes. In canescens, the non-glandular trichomes are located only at one side of the stem. And generally, they're alternated in the nodes. Also, another feature that we can notice is the form and the length and the size of the chlorenchyma cells at the stem. So Stylosanthes gracilis has these chlorenchymatic cells more elongated, while in the other taxa, they are more round shape and they're small. This was very interesting because sometimes Stylosanthes gracilis is treated as a variety of Stylosanthes guineensis in many treatments. And we found another characteristic that can differentiate Stylosanthes gracilis than the other taxa of the Stylosanthes guineensis complex. Remember that fiber caps, sometimes they're bigger at the border of the leaflets instead of the some species that are regular sized in the mesophyll. So Stylosanthes gracilis has these bigger fiber caps in the border. And when we look to the leaflet macroscopically, we can notice that the daxial vein is very prominent. This finding was also encountered in other taxa. So the larger fiber caps occur in Gracilis, Aurea, Acuminata, and Guianensis variety pulsiflora. Also, when we have these larger fiber caps, the eccentric mid event is eccentric, it's not located at the center of the mesophyll. Also, the location of the emergence at the leaflets were also distinctive in some taxa. So in some taxa, they occur only in the mid-event and the border in the margin of the leaflets. And others, they occur widespread in the leaflet blades. Now I'm gonna talk a little bit of the more taxonomy study. There are only preliminary results. We haven't published it yet. So I just give you some examples. So we pretended to produce a synopsis with identification keys, species comments, illustrations, maps, and conservation status of the species. And until now, we have found 34 species for Brazil. So one of the biggest quests of a taxonomist is to find where are the types. What's a type? A type is a herbarium material in which the name of the plant is attached. For example, we have here Stylosanthes valsi. So we have a material deposit at the same herbarium that when we look to it, we have certainly that this is the Stylosanthes valsi. So it's a problem when we go to the herbarium and we have to find all this material because we don't have the certainty on which we're calling the plant name. So one of these examples is the Stylosanthes longicarpa that we only have the description and the types were not found. In the prologue, it was said that the holotype was at the PMG herbarium, but when I contacted the curator, she said to me that the type was never located. So I decided to contact Professor Joseph Valls, that was the collector of the specimen. And he said to me that, well, probably this material may be at my cabinet that was never mounted and was there since the 80s. So thankfully he could open it and he really found the type material. Not the holotype, but there are duplicates from the type that was studied by Brandão and Souza Costa. Since we haven't found the true holotype, now this material will become a lactatification of the name Stylosanthes longicarpa. Other example is Stylosanthes hippocampoides. In the prologue, it was said the holotype was here at the New York Botanical Garden. But when I start to look in the type material, I haven't found it. So it wasn't here. So I was getting a little upset. However, when I was start to analyze other Stylosanthes material, I saw a plant and berry sheet with the label that was the same that Moldenbrock described in the specimen. So the type was actually here, but was stored under another name and was in the middle of the regular collection. So we have more to present. So we have more lactotypes, new synonyms than I'm proposing. We pretend to reestablish some names and also publish new species. We recently submitted a new species to the Britannia. So after my doctorate for the future, I have a collaboration of Professor Dr. Gustavo Souza from University of Pernambuco. He's recently working with molecular phylogenetics and evolution of the genus. And also I have a collaboration with Dr. Mario Tomazello from the ESALQ. And he's working with X-ray images. So I realized some X-ray images from the Stylosanthes to better understand the venation patterns in the leaves. And we hope with all this data, we can solve problematic species. I wanna thank initially CAPS for the scholarship that gave me the opportunity to be here. Also CNPq for also funding the research. The Institute of Biosciences of Botucatu and UNESP that where I'm located now. I must always thank ESALQ, that is my alma mater, but especially now because Professor Mario Tomazelli is there and helping with the X-ray images. Also thank Embrapa and of course here the New York Botanical Garden. And for people, I want initially thank Dr. Ana Paula Fortuna Perez, that she's my advisor. She's been great. And of course, Professor Ben, that's been so welcoming here. And Dr. Douglas, that he's not in the paper, but of course he's an advisor for life. It's been a huge pleasure to be here with them, and many, many people that I want thanks for.
Well, thank you, Danilo, for that wonderful presentation. If any of you in the audience have questions, please enter them in the Q&A session, and I will read those to Danilo. I don't see any questions in there right now, so if you have anything on your mind, please go ahead and put it in there. I guess I'll start off with a couple of questions that I had. Danilo, you mentioned the two sections of Stylosanthes and the fact that they're distinguished partly by this aborted axis in the inflorescence, so an aborted sort of stem. Mm-hmm. Has there been any, and you said you thought that actually that's an aborted flower?
Uh-huh.
Have you done some developmental work, or has anyone done developmental work on the inflorescences to ascertain that, or what makes you think that it's a flower?
Well, not yet. What makes us think that it's a flower, because sometimes other people have found some vestigial parts of flower in the tip of this rudimentary axis. But of course, we need more developmental work to have it certain. I've already talked to Professor Juliana from University of Rio de Janeiro. But of course, the pandemic just ruining many projects we were hoping for. But that's an open question that we need to solve.
Okay, there's a question in the Q&A from Martin Nickel. Who is doing the wonderful illustration? Are you drawing yourself?
Unfortunately, I have no talent for drawing. So I have a good friend in Brazil. She's called Maíra. She has done these wonderful illustrations for me.
Okay, I don't remember if you mentioned or not the fact that there are some, is it two species of Stylosanthes that are in Africa?
Actually, they're in the most recent treatment, it's considered four. I never got into too deep to see if they're good species or not, since I'm more focused on the Brazilian ones. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping to see them in further time to see that they're very good species. But now they're considering five species of Stylosanthes in the world.
So it's interesting because obviously the majority of the diversity of the 50 or so species are in the New World, in the New World tropics mainly. And I'm wondering if you have some thoughts on that disjunction, how old it is or how it might have come about.
Well, in some phylogenetic studies, it has been said that it has a recent evolution, and when we see the clades, the African species just are emerged in mixture with the American species. So it probably it emerged after the disjunction. So I believe that's by dispersion actually.
Okay, so the four African species don't actually come out together in the same clade then. That's interesting.
Yeah. Actually, when we run some of the trees, few things we can withdrew off from it because even morphology, distribution is all gathered together.
Mm-hmm. I don't see more questions here, but there are a couple of comments from Juan Nikolai. I wanted to congratulate Danilo for your beautiful presentation. From Robert Mullenbrock, great job, Danilo. I learned a lot. Here's a question from Sergio Guzman. What will you be focusing on after publishing what you have showed us? I'm thrilled. Thank you.
Well, first, I want to say just I'm really excited by Robert Mullenbrock here because I invited him. He made the first revision of the genus. I use a lot of his work. So thank you very much, Robert, for watching my presentation. I'm so flattered. So Sergio, actually I pretend to go deeper and perhaps in anatomy, because there are some interesting points that I haven't reached already in the Stylosanthes. So I focus more on these, the leaf and the stems, but also there's this question about the development of the flower, if those rudimentary axes are flowers or not, or just trying to understand the evolution of the secretory emergences within the Dalbergieae.
Great. Let's see. I had one other question here, if I can find it in my list. You mentioned some ongoing phylogenetic work that's being done by other people. And, you know, one of the issues with studying evolution at the species level, at these kind of shallow phylogenetic levels, is that you're usually dealing with a poorly resolved phylogeny. Do you think that, are these people using like next generation sequencing techniques, or do you think there's much hope of getting a really well-resolved species level phylogeny for Stylosanthes?
When we think about more wider sample within all plenty of terminals, plenty of species, these people are only using little markers from the nuclei. But Dr. Gustavo recently published an article when he got more into genomically of the Stylosanthes, but he's just a few species, just Captata, Viscosa, and other groups. The problem with making these phylogenies is when we are dealing with the allotetraploid species. Because if you use the chloroplast, we have one topology, and if you use the nuclei, we have another topology. I don't know if you're still seeing my presentation, but like you can see, this is the difference of the topology of species when you use different organelles. So sometimes it's better to use only the diploid species and after try to understand where this tetraploid is may fit in.
So in addition to polyploidy, are there also hybrids between, interspecific hybrids, so hybrids between species?
I believe so. So that occurs a lot, especially when it's in the herbarium. We see some plants that you see, oh, this is part from one species, part from another. And I believe they can interbreed a lot.
Well, thank you, Danilo. This has been a very interesting presentation. I think that all of us listening learned a lot and enjoyed it. And as I said, if Danilo's here through April, if you haven't met Danilo and would like to have an opportunity to speak with him, he's on the fourth floor of the library building. He's right, basically right next to my office, which is 468. So
and 466, the old Scott Murray office.
Yeah. So again, thanks, Danilo. And
thank you.
Let me just finish up with some closing remarks, which I have written here. If you missed any part of the event or wish to watch it again, a recording has been saved and it will be published in the NYBG lecture library in the science section. Thank you for being with us today, and we hope you'll join us for future science webinars. Until next time, please stay well. Goodbye, everyone, and thank you once again, Danilo.
Thanks, Ben.